Anchorage, Alaska. This city of nearly a quarter million residents has been called the City of Miracles by some, and a planning and engineering nightmare by others. In a land of extremes, this is a city of extremes, a city that has experienced a roller coaster ride of good and bad times during its 70 years of existence. But this is a city that has always been on the move, trying to forge an urban reality based on big dreams in an unlikely northern outpost. Always on the lookout for economic opportunity. Always wanting to be a real all-American city with paved roads and lighted streets and a stable population of people with steady jobs. Today, thanks to billions of dollars in government spending during the past decade, Anchorage has largely realized its original dream. Now the city strives to be a cultural center, patron of the arts, and host to world-class sporting events. But like the economic foundation on which Anchorage was originally built, today's source of economy is subject to serious fluctuations. And now that oil revenues are in serious decline, what will become of Anchorage and its hopes and its dreams? Anchorage is the largest of Alaska's cities, but it is not one of the oldest. Unlike many other Alaskan cities whose history is linked to the Russian fur trade of 200 years ago and the days of the gold rush, Anchorage has little of that sort of romantic past. Like hundreds of cities across the nation, Anchorage was created by a railroad, and it would always reflect that essentially all-American character and set the city apart from the rest of the state. It was 1915 when the Alaska Engineering Commission chose Anchorage as the headquarters of the Alaska Railroad. By then, word had gotten out about the new development on the shore of Cook Inlet, and practically overnight, a stampede city of ragged tents and rude shacks sprung up on Ship Creek Flats. Mike Carberry, a senior planner for the municipality and author of a book on early Anchorage planning, describes how the current town site came into being.
Thousands of people poured into the area in the late spring of 1915. And this resulted in a tent city down below the bluff. This was basically a plateau, a forested plateau up here where the town site came to be. There was health problems. People were throwing out their garbage on the outgoing tide. You had people setting up shops, would-be entrepreneurs that had tent establishments down below a little main street even within the tent city. And between the health problems and people clamoring for land, it was time to get on with the actual town building. Andrew Christensen had come up from Juneau. He was one of the three commissioners which were selected. Mears was already here with the Army, and they must have collaborated. This is supposition to some degree. However, there was an urgency. T-square grid town planning was something that was typically done over the West, and within a course of a matter of weeks, this was the building season was moving on. We were into June. Something had to be done, and the town site was cleared, and the plat had been prepared, and the lots were begun to be staked. And then in, I believe it was early July, you had the first auction.
The commission laid out a 350-acre town site on the bluff above the railroad yards and sold the land at auction to those willing to put down roots and at least $25. Later, a local government was established, a school was opened, and the commission installed a utility system for the growing community. Anchorage was thoroughly a government town, and its residents lived by the almost military-like regulations established by the Federal Engineering Commission. But Anchorage was on the move as America's northernmost outpost of economic development and urbanization. The first of many blows to Anchorage's economy occurred when the U.S. entered the First World War. Money which might have gone into the railroad was diverted to the war effort. Fully half of the population, including much of the railroad workforce, left by 1920. When the railroad was completed in 1923, it was behind schedule. The government's priorities had changed, and worst of all, the federal government found the railroad was uneconomic to run. But despite the failure of the railroad to meet economic expectations, Anchorage continued to grow by small and sometimes painful increments, relying on congressional appropriations for the railroad. Then came the Great Depression of the 1930s. While the Depression did not dramatically affect the relatively isolated economy of Anchorage, the economic recovery program of the New Deal did result in public works projects, which provided work for local residents. The Depression era also brought new residents. The Matanuska Valley, 40 miles north of Anchorage, became a colony in which people from poverty-stricken rural areas of America were resettled in what was to become an agricultural community. The colony was to demonstrate the feasibility of high-latitude agriculture in North America and free Alaska from dependence on supplies from outside. Despite the desperate condition of the national economy, in Alaska there was room for the kind of optimism that accompanies a people opening a new land. Bob Atwood, publisher of the Anchorage Times, came to Anchorage during the Great Depression.
And Anchorage had been beating the drums for the development of agriculture in the Matanuska Valley for 20 years before I got here. And when I got here and learned about it, it was already going. The same summer that I arrived, the Matanuska Valley colonists arrived. A New Deal project, financed by the federal government, brought 200 families from the Midwest and put them on farms in the Matanuska Valley, and grub-staked them with the commissary services to feed them and with help to build their houses and get their farms started. That activity up there caused what the local people here called a boom. We were in a boom when I arrived. And it seemed to me quite dead for a boom, but it was exciting to everybody here. We found that it did upset things here because this colony, which was going to supply vegetables and food for Anchorage and other places, at first they had none, and they came down here and bought all of ours, and we ran out. So we were short, and we had to, our stores had to augment their orders on the next boat. And there time again, we had to hurry down to store to buy something first, or else the farmers would get it up there. And it was quite, until we got adjusted, it upset things. The impact, we always had impacts, and we still hear about impacts.
An even greater impact occurred when the Pacific Theater of World War II opened in the early 1940s. The Japanese attacked the Aleutian Islands, and Anchorage underwent dramatic change. A rude highway was built from the continental United States to Alaska, and troops and supplies flooded into the territory. The pre-war population of Anchorage was 4,000. By 1941, the city registered 9,000. The boom in new residents, both military and non-military, placed severe demands on municipal services. By the end of the war, Anchorage's population had grown to nearly 12,000. With a permanent military presence, the city for the first time had a semblance of a stable population base. But with the end of the war came the end of the economic boom. Anchorage's economy teetered on the edge of depression in the post-war years. It was not until post-war tensions between the Soviet Union and the United States heated to Cold War conditions that the economy of Alaska, and especially Anchorage, was rescued. The advent of the Cold War and the construction of early warning defense stations and increased military buildup helped stabilize the weak economic base. Still, Anchorage and the state as a whole continued to hope an economic activity would soon come along and provide a stable year-round source of jobs for local residents. As remarkable as it is ironic, the lagging economy of Anchorage was rescued on March 27, 1964 at 5:48 p.m. A powerful earthquake measuring 8.4 on the Richter scale severely damaged the city. Much of the main business district on 3rd, 4th, and 5th Avenues was a twisted wreckage, and many of the town's exclusive homes in the Turnagain area were ruined. Millions of dollars in federal reconstruction aid poured into the city and provided a significant boost to the troubled economy. Within a year after the great earthquake, the Anchorage Bowl began filling with multi-storied buildings and homes. While reconstruction contributed much, the development of oil fields on the Kenai Peninsula provided a source of stable jobs and an increasing presence in Alaska by oil companies. Little did those who experienced the brief but substantial euphoria of post-earthquake reconstruction know that the boom of booms was just a few years away. In 1968, a large and long hoped for Alaska resource-based economy was finally born. Atlantic Richfield Company found the richest reservoir of oil in North America. It was in Alaska's Arctic. Because Anchorage had positioned itself as the center of business and commerce in the state, the city reaped many benefits from oil development. New state and federal government agencies came to Anchorage, as did a number of oil companies. The $9 billion the oil industry spent to construct the Trans-Alaska Pipeline helped to change the face of Anchorage more dramatically than ever before. Between 1970 and 1975, the population of Anchorage grew 40%. At the end of the pipeline construction project in 1977, Anchorage's economy seemed doomed to another period of stagnation. Like the end of the railroad construction in 1923, the end of New Deal growth following the Great Depression, and the post-war years in the 1940s, civic leaders began to wonder how to sustain the level of services that the city, now combined into a huge municipality of some 180,000 people, had come to expect. Then the oil began to flow. Those who were gladdened by the boom of the pipeline construction period were pleased beyond their wildest dreams at the effect of billions upon billions of dollars flowing to the state treasury from royalties on oil production. By the late 1970s, that wealth was being transferred in the form of loans to businesses, grants to local government and nonprofit organizations, and massive state public works projects. Growth happened quickly, too quickly for Anchorage planners to react. Perhaps the most visible failure of the municipality to cope with growth was in providing an adequate transportation system. George Sullivan was mayor of the municipality of Anchorage at the time.
One of the problems we ran into is that we brought a plan as required by the law, the federal and state law, to the public for highways in this area. And it was resoundingly turned down. It was a meeting at Sidney Lawrence Auditorium, and the people were told at that time, you know, that this is 4 years, 5 years, 6 years hence, and it has to be done. You're going to be having these problems on roads and everything. And they weren't suffering badly at that time, and we warned them they would be, and they turned it down. And when you do that, this was in the mid to late 70s, they were told that, you know, this money's going to go to other places. We have to go back to square one and start redesign and everything else on this, and we're going to lose 3, 4, 5 years probably on highway work around here, and the people are going to be hurting, and it's what happened.
Walt Parker, a former member of the Anchorage Assembly, contends the flaw in the plan was the incorrect placement of proposed road corridors.
Some people were just against any freeways. The major problem with the original AMATs was that the freeways were in the wrong spot. They didn't really correspond to any future of Anchorage that a good many of the rest of us who were here at that time foresaw. And instead of coming back to the municipality immediately and sitting down with the borough and the city and working out a freeway program that was acceptable, the highway department went back to Juneau, spent all the money up in Fairbanks until I became commissioner in 1974, so 5 years were essentially lost to Anchorage at a very critical period, coming in on the pipeline boom, why there'd been very little road development for 5 years because of the antagonism there.
As Anchorage entered the 1980s, laboring under a 10% annual growth rate, the highest in the nation, and with too few streets and roads, There was another significant problem, according to Municipal Planning Director Bill Luria, an outdated land use system.
What I saw, and I think what the administration saw when we came on board, was a land use system that was put in place well over a decade ago. Land use tools to control growth and development, to manage growth and development, tools that were here in the mid-70s. And this town was much different than it is now. Population is almost doubled. And we just, what I saw is we didn't have the necessary tools to deal with that growth. And I think what we're doing over the last few years is to try to bring our land use code up to the 20th century to deal with the growth that that's taken place in the 80s. And that's why we've seen lots of changes being introduced to catch up. Changes that deal with the issues I said before. How can we make growth and development compatible with existing neighborhoods? And how can we make sure the quality of that growth is a pretty high standard and not the schlock stuff that tend to have happened early on? There's a lot of people that are really concerned about the type of development that's taken place in the late 70s and the real early part of the 80s. A combination of two things. One, it just happened so quick. All of a sudden, this community, along with this state, got a ton of money, free money, thrown on us. And all of a sudden, from no money to lots of money to do anything we want with. And people started to do things, a lot of activity, a lot of positive activity. But as I said, we had a land use system that was over a decade old to try to deal with it, and it just couldn't. We just couldn't handle the growth and development in the way that we'd like to.
According to Anchorage Planning Commissioner Greg Jones, there are reasons why the planning tools and the transportation infrastructure were not put in place in the 1970s.
Our initial response to growth, which occurred in the early 1970s, was to shun it, was to try to avoid it. We had seen so many different responses over the years, so many other cities encounter problems related to growth, that in 1970, 71, 72, the pre-pipeline hysteria set in, and people didn't want the growth to ever occur. There was a series of proposals at that time to limit infrastructure. We had a comprehensive plan draft written by the planning department that put a lid on the Anchorage population. It proposed to cap the growth, just, you know, the cap was 250,000. I've got a copy of that draft. It's fascinating reading now, because their intent was to allow the city to grow to 250,000 and just stop it. And the attempt by a governmental entity to say, okay, we're going to limit growth by not building sewers, and that was part of some of those type of things were done also, and not building roads, really doesn't keep people from coming to the community. It just eliminates the ability to handle the growth. The people arrive, and they are going to live somewhere. They're either going to move further and further out, and we have constraints on our edges with the state park and the water and the military boundaries, or they're going to crowd in, which ends up creating health problems. And we have stream pollution now. We have contamination of wells on the hillside. We have some of the worst development that any community has ever seen in some of the more dense parts of our community, because there was a demand to house these people, and it didn't matter what you built, it was going to get occupied. So the commercial development and the residential development that occurred in the early 70s was some of the worst that the city's ever seen. And it was because the city didn't provide a creative method to accommodate the growth. It was a lack of planning.
Today, Anchorage planning is high tech. Using the technology of computers, planners try to implement the city's comprehensive plan and zoning laws. But according to Planning Director Luria, there is a fundamental problem which technology can't cure.
What we're being faced now that we have this growth, is a comprehensive plan saying one thing and a zoning pattern that says is another, and people are either trying to make the zoning compatible with the comprehensive plan, or they're saying, well, we have zoning, and therefore that's what we want to develop to, even though people will say, but it's different, it conflicts with the comprehensive plan. And that's the real
hassle in the decision-making process. And there's a third element, the third dimension to it, is that a lot of the development that actually took place on the ground was different than what the comprehensive plan said and different than what zoning said. So we have one set of laws that says this is what the zoning is, another law that says this is what the comprehensive plan believes as a guide development should be, and a third dimension, what actually happened on the ground, which may have been totally different than both of those.
Public hearing item 2, Jack White.
The inconsistencies between zoning laws and the comprehensive plan are resolved by elected and appointed officials through a process called variance and rezoning. This is where the municipality's computer plays an important role.
What we're doing now, formally, and those adopted by the Assembly, is to group rezonings by geographic area, by neighborhoods. So at one particular time, we take all the land use change requests for an area and look at them together. So instead of seeing each change in isolation, we're looking at each land use change in the context of everything else taking place in the neighborhood. And it's done at a consistent time, twice a year, every 6 months. So the community knows that at this point in time, both the Assembly and the Planning and Zoning Commission will deal with all the land use changes in their neighborhood. And it's really working. I think most people are very, very happy with it. Because what we're seeing is, again, the effect of, when you look at one little change, it doesn't mean anything. But you put a whole string of them together, you really see a different dynamic taking place in the neighborhood. And I think both the Planning and Zoning Commission and the Assembly have told us that it's really helped them in their decision making. They really get a sense of what growth is doing to a neighborhood.
Anchorage seems to have come to the end of a growth spurt as it enters the final third of the 1980s. Perhaps it is just another of the temporary economic valleys Anchorage has experienced so often in the past. Perhaps another boom is just around the corner. But if not, this valley will thoroughly test the priorities of Anchorageites. After having built public amenities over the past decade totaling nearly $1 billion, many of which will require millions of dollars annually in operations and maintenance costs, residents can now expect to see a sizable increase in taxes and user fees. Barry Quinn, Director of Capital Projects for the municipality.
As you consider the operations and maintenance costs of each of the facilities, you have to kind of look at them individually. I think the overall impact, without a question, means we have, it's going to have an increased impact on the on taxes. There's no way to get around it when you're building that size of a program. But at the same time, I think it's important to compare what we have available to us now and what other communities of our size have done to develop the same type of capital program, whether they're building new libraries, performing arts centers, new police station, headquarters police stations, maintenance and repair facilities for our transit system. Most communities have had to bond to finance this type of project. And the cost of financing, both the principal and the interest, ends up in an operating budget. And so as we look around the country, we see a lot of communities that have enormous operating budgets, and a good portion of that is debt service they're paying on bonds. We've been extremely fortunate to be able to buy the facilities that we're living with and enjoying today with cash. And so when we look at our operating budgets, I think we can be thankful that the cost of operating these facilities is really the pure cost of it. We've come through a tremendous growth period. We have the advantage of having new facilities and facilities that will be with us and serving us long into the future.
The future of Anchorage is anybody's guess. But in the short run, according to Mayor Tony Knowles, the city is in a period of adjustment to lower revenues.
There's going to be a lot of adjusting to more of a payment for the services, by the people who receive the benefits of those services, as opposed to direct state grants. And we're going through that process now. And you do sort out what things you want to pay for and what things you say, well, no, we don't want to afford them. We've cut back in the last 3 years 450 positions in the municipality. We've raised all types of fees for services given, and people have the option, such as the swimming pool program, which pays for itself, basically. If you want to swim, you pay for it. If you don't, you don't have to pay for it. It's not part of the tax. There are certain programs, though, that we must, and we don't want to let fall behind, and I look upon those as our public safety programs. There's, of course, the traditional police and fire, an emergency medical service. We have to keep those, and we have some of the finest departments in the nation right here in Anchorage, and I don't want to see those drop. And we have to pay more, we'll pay more. And I'm going to continue to push that, because that's a quality of life, an essence of life type of service that I think we're very fortunate to have the quality services that we have in that, and I'm a big proponent in making sure that we keep that quality.
Given the economic problems Anchorage faces, is there room for optimism? Economist Scott Hawkins says, yes.
I'm optimistic long term. In the short term, we do have some challenges to meet, I guess is the most tactful way to put it. The budget cuts that are looming before the legislature and the governor, the potential for either tax increases or spending cuts that have a very damaging effect on the economy could affect many thousands of people here in the short term. Compared to a year ago, Anchorage is down, I don't have the number handy, but somewhere in the neighborhood of 7,000-8,000 jobs. And if our budget decisions are not sensitive to the economic ramifications, then we can lose that many jobs and more again. So in the short term, we really have kind of a damage minimization. We have to figure out a way to mitigate the downside potential of this budget thing while some of these other things take some time to get into gear.
What industry or event will rescue Anchorage's economy in the 1980s? If history has shown us anything in Anchorage, the source of the next economic boom will be just as hard to predict as were all the others. The silver lining in the current dark economic cloud is that Anchorage has time to dream and time to plan for the next inevitable period of growth.